The Love Doctor, Episode 015, The Waterslide Aquatic Simulator, Human Sexuality, Self-Indulgence, and the Bathtub Technique with Maureen Pollock.
This is Dr. Charles Reynolds, inventor of the O-Shot, and thank you for joining Dr. Emily Porter, the Austin Love Doctor, as she openly discusses your most intimate questions regarding relationships, sex, and personal wellness through the eyes of a medical doctor who treats men and women for a variety of sexual issues using the latest medical advancements available. Get comfortable, relax, and welcome your host, Dr. Emily Porter.
Hi there, it's Dr. Porter. Thanks for joining me today. And I am so excited. I have Ms. Maureen Pollock from Connecticut, and she is the inventor of this really handy dandy and very beautiful little invention called the Water Slide. And it's water, and slide is spelled cutesy with a Y. And the website's waterslide.com. And it is a neat little thing that she came up with as a Jewish woman that was a way for her to incorporate kind of a ritual cleansing with a female's pleasure. And thanks, Maureen, for joining us. Tell us a little bit about you and about your background and kind of how you came up with this idea.
Sure. Thanks, Dr. Emily, for having me. So I guess I came up with the idea by accident when I was 15. And I was in the bathtub and I went to sit up and the faucet popped off. And behind the faucet is a pipe that shoots the water straight out if the faucet wasn't there. And being 15 and, you know, I guess society saying that I can't have sex and I didn't have many options for masturbation, but at the same time, my hormones were raging. I jumped back out of surprise with the water. It landed somewhere else. And let's just say it took about 4 baths a day. my father fixed the faucet. Yes, it was glorious. My father fixed it. I was craving that sensation so much, I started scooting underneath the bathtub faucet that later I found out a lot of other girls my age figured out how to do. And I always wanted the water to still come to me as opposed to scooting under the faucet. Fast forward about 15 years, and I'm speaking with my OBGYN after having 2 kids, and libido is great, everything's wonderful. And she says, what do you attribute that to? And I say, well, I still scoot under the faucet. And she goes, well, that would be nice if we could bottle that and give it to all the patients. And I said, well, why don't you invent something actually instead of scooting under the faucet, like a water diverter that brings the water to you? Just in passing, kind of like, run with this. This is your department. And 3 days later, she called me and said, I hope you don't mind. I shared your idea about the water diverter with the practice. And we all agree this is a brilliant idea, not just for feminine hygiene, but for self-pleasure. And we want to invest. That was my aha moment. Like, wait a minute, a professional in the industry wants to throw money behind it. It's not just a friend saying, this is a great idea. So I went ahead and called a patent attorney and I got the green light and used a 3D printer. And here we are today.
Oh, it's through a 3D printer. That's really, I wondered how you made it. It's because it's made of plastic. They make those for kids. They call them like the Aqua Duck, and we have them. It basically is so you have your toddler and their hands don't reach under the faucet when they're standing on the step stool. It doesn't make quite as, it's a little bit wider spread of the water, but it extends the water out too. So it's kind of the same idea, just totally used for a different purpose. But those accidental inventions are the best. And you're right about being 15. I mean, honestly, I've done that. I would ask our listeners who didn't probably slide underneath the faucet at some point. But, you know, I found that you lay back and then somehow when your butt's scooched all the way that it needs to be for you to get like the water on your clitoris to feel good, it also means you're stopping up the drain and then you've got water rising and it's getting in your ears and then you're having to kind of interrupt things. So,
yes. Do I want to breathe or do I want to finish? Which one?
I know. It's like, I guess there's some people that are into that kink, right? Where it's like, I'm so suffocating and I got to pick one and maybe the timer of how, which one's going to happen first, that thrill is helpful for some people. But and I want to talk a little bit more about feminine hygiene. I get that question a lot. I think that women inherently and I'm not Jewish, so I'll be interesting to hear, and you don't certainly speak on behalf of the entire Jewish community, but hygiene certainly is more spoken about religiously there than it is for my point of view anyway. But people are obsessed with the smell of their vagina, and women are rubbing and washing and cleansing, and what cleanser should I use? And you know, I'm always just saying to them, if water isn't doing enough, like there's probably something else going on. I mean, yeah, if you're on your menses, when you have blood hits air, there's going to be a little bit more odor. But if you're not menstruating, like your vagina really shouldn't smell. There should be something else going on, but you also shouldn't need to be douching or using anything really other than just water. You got to expose things though. I think women need to understand their bodies. I think they need to understand what a clitoris is and what a clitoral hood is, and just the way men are supposed to clean on the glands or the head of their penis, especially if they're uncircumcised. Women have a clitoral hood, which is the equivalent of the male foreskin. They really need to pull that all the way back. And just some warm water. If you're going to use anything, ladies, it should only be externally, and something very gentle like Cetaphil or Dove, but you really shouldn't need anything. And Maureen's invention kind of has you covered. So talk a little bit more about water.
Sure. So with the OBGYN, she mentioned to me that the medical journals actually at the same time came out saying douching is out and even mild soaps are out. Like you said, it's a self-cleaning oven. And they said water washing over the labia is the best way for us to get clean. And when you said women are obsessed with their smell, I would love to turn it into women being obsessed with their scent. We do have a natural, beautiful scent. And with that being said, after a long day, if you're out, it's a dark, moist area, bacteria grows, and we have our own pH level, and we want to keep it healthy. So adding different chemicals, soaps, perfumes, changes your pH level. So again, external water washing over the labia. And in terms of Jewish practices, after we menstruate, we go to a ritual bath 7 days after you're done. And there, you're supposed to clean your whole entire body. And it does touch on the feminine side. So it says clean between the folds, pull back. You want any dead skin cells washed off your body before you go into the mikvah. And it never once says anything about soaps. It says water washing over your, and this has been around for like thousands of years that they've been saying this. So there's more to it. But in terms of feminine hygiene, you're absolutely right. Water over the labia, external.
Well, and I mean, I'm not a huge bath person only because the time and my children are, you know, they now have taken over my bathtub, right? There's toys everywhere. And but I have some women that really are into their bath and their glass of wine at night. Like there's some women, yeah, I used to be more baths, but now it's like, who has the time? And then they make you sleepy, right? So it'd have to be like the last thing I do before I go to bed. They do in a lot of baths with pregnancy though and delivery, and my nanny is about to have her baby, and I know there's water births aside, just having women labor in the tub, and I did that with my second child. But I'm just thinking, combining the idea of some women find clitoral stimulation or masturbation to be very like relaxing during childbirth. Gosh, wouldn't that be cool if you had your water slide and you were going into your hospital room and you had your bath and you were laboring and you're sitting there, instead of having pain, you're having, you know, all this orgasm from during your delivery. Gosh, it makes me want to have another baby.
Good.
I had a hysterectomy, girl. I don't think I'm having any more, but
anymore either, but let's do it for science.
For science, yeah. Maybe we should start promoting that, or maybe I should start giving it to women as part of their, instead of their baby gift, maybe we should give it to the pregnant mommies at their baby showers.
Like, here, yeah, and that's the thing, after delivery with labor, the cold water, you could use it as like a soothing, trickling water washing over you. I wouldn't say turn it on full force and have a full-blown orgasm, and definitely speak to your doctor because your cervix is still open, so you don't want water shooting inside. But having like a sitz bath or the trickling of cool water is used right now with oncologists for people who are having vaginal oncology, burning after radiation. So I'm curious to see if after delivery, if it would be a nice soothing product as well.
Yeah, I would say for those women after a bath, it probably, from a physician perspective, you're right, the service isn't fully closed down for 6 weeks, but they certainly give you one of those little squirty bottles and they tell you to squirt on the toilet. And I mean, I bled for a long time afterward. And I think probably if they're just positioning themselves where, like you said, it's not legs up in the air, full on stream going in there, but certainly a sitz bath and maybe have the water on, not on full blast, I think that would be totally fine. It's no different than the squirt bottle that you're squirting. Just keep the perfumed soaps and things, bubble bath and things out of there. But that would be really cool. Yeah. So, yeah, and we have a pool and a hot tub. And I know there's a lot of women that find the jets to be very stimulating and things. It can be forceful for some. I think that's what's cool about the water slide is that you can control it. So it's not you having to shimmy up to something and kind of being dependent on some other water, but you're in complete control, which is nice for most women.
Yes, it's great to be in control. And it's nice to sit back and relax too.
Yeah, yeah. So when you and I talked on the phone a couple of weeks ago, we talked a little bit about the idea of about cleanliness and really sort of abstinence during a woman's menstrual cycle as not just part of a cleanliness thing, but as part of a spiritual thing. And then this idea of the mikveh afterward. And you had told me that that also had great benefits for your marriage in terms of spicing things up. Can you share that with our audience a little bit more? Because I thought those were great tips. It makes me want to just put it on the calendar, even though I don't have a period anymore. Like, yeah, just pretend like I do so that I can benefit.
Sure, sure. So when I first learned about it, I did a marriage class right before I was getting married, and they just pretty much laid it out as, these are the rules. This is what's been going on for thousands of years, and nobody ever talks about it. I never heard about it beforehand. So essentially the rules are, from the second a woman menstruates, even if it's like a light red color, if it's over a dime-sized spot, let's say on an underwear, you could see, that's when you begin. And it ends 7 days after you're finished menstruating. So when you're finished menstruating, you actually take these white cloths called the Dika strips, and you insert them, and you take them out, and you examine them. Every day after you're done menstruating, you count, today is day one of my clean day. Today is 2 days, all the way up to seven. And during, it's called your in-nida. When you're in-nida, you are not allowed to touch your spouse. You are not allowed to, obviously have sex if you can't touch them. You are not allowed to sleep in the same bed. You are not allowed to pass things to each other. Like if you're sitting at the dining room table and you want to pass the salt, you put it on the table and they have to take it. You become, from that, hypersensitive and hyper aware of each other's bodies and presence. You have to learn how to resolve issues without physical touch. You have to talk things out. You can't just tackle each other. And as the days go on, that becomes a forbidden fruit. At least for me, it has driven me insane. I would say on day four, just him walking by and the wind from him passing, I could feel his presence. And I end up craving him. And it's insane. Like, we've been married 13 years and together for 2 years before that. And I am way more into and more attracted to him than I've ever been. And not, I shouldn't say this publicly, but it is one of those rules I feel like kind of when you break, it's insane. So you feel like you're having an affair, but with your husband. And that's not a very popular thought, but I think it's an incredible aspect that comes from it, because everybody I've spoken to says they miss the passion. That you want something new sometimes. I don't honestly have that, because I have that almost every month. And if I can make it till the end of it, you go and your mindset, your intention for being with your spouse, you then go to the mikvah. So on your seventh clean day, it's on your calendar. You are both counting down every day. And he takes care of everything in the house. He puts the kids to bed. It is now my spa day. That is a day where you, if you've ever watched movies with royalty or Cleopatra, it has that essence. I have women who are taking care of my body, checking every inch of me to making sure that there's no blemishes. I'm taking a shower, like everything. Like, it's a full-blown indulgence. And then I go into this holy water, which it has to be part natural water, like one third has to be from the rain. I go in and I come out, and that's my most spiritual place in the world. There's like, that's where I pray. That's, and I'm not very spiritual, I would say, in other areas. That's my spot. And then I come out, and you have to, they say, almost with your hair dripping wet, you have to go home and make love. Like, you have to. I don't care if you are in the biggest fight in the world. I don't care what the circumstances are. You don't plan your business trips around there. You don't have movie tickets. That is your night to get it on. So if you could imagine what it's like after 12 days of not touching, reuniting physically, it is incredibly powerful. And it's like a honeymoon period every single month. So
there's so many things there that I love. Like I said, and that connect back to some of my other podcasts. So we talked about scheduled sex a couple weeks ago that I recorded. And, you know, the idea of just spaghetti night once a week, like something to look forward to, like something that you know it's going to happen, that there's no excuses about I'm too tired or whatever. And just spaghetti night in the sense that if you have little kids at home, there's maybe something that you do every week, Taco Tuesday or whatever, and you make it kind of a habit. I love the concept of coming home and being relaxed and clean, and my husband took care of everything. Like, oh wait, he put the kids to bed and he like did the laundry. And I guess if he knows he's getting some, like what wouldn't a guy do if he knew he was like, right? They probably mop the floor and vacuum if he told them.
Yes.
They were going to get some passionate sex and it was guaranteed and you weren't going to flake out on them. So I love that. Yeah. And I also love the idea from a natural family planning standpoint when we're talking about not putting necessarily, I did a podcast on oral contraceptives, and even for women who don't use natural family planning, but like really oral contraceptives can do things for libido, right? Estrogen can just tank your testosterone levels, your free testosterone levels, by binding your sex hormone binding globulin. And they can just do lots of things that women don't love. That, great, yeah, you're not going to get pregnant, but you also don't want to have sex and you don't have as good of orgasm. And so it's just convenient that around day 12 for most women, 12 to 13 to 14 is kind of when they're ovulating. So if they're missing that, as they, our ancestors were so smart, man. Like, yeah, all these things that they did to plan to the survival of the species, you know, because around that day or mid-cycle when you're ovulating is also when you have a testosterone surge. So we talked about that wait, I happen to be horny then too, naturally, because I'm ovulating. Your cervical mucus is thinner. So it's like it's a water slide. Look at that. It's slippery and you're horny and you're clean and your husband is like taking care of you. And if you want to get pregnant and you're not on the pill, then boom, it's easier as well.
Yes.
So all those great things. The Catholics took the natural family planning. That's their like only, you know, authorized form of birth control by the church. Different church, but kind of the same concept. And goes around cycles and timing.
Yeah, it's all together. And it builds things. They also say another element with intimacy that doesn't necessarily always have to do with sex is what happens when people naturally, their libidos drop when they're older, a lot older. Of course, they're still sexual beings, but sex doesn't become as much of a focus for some people. I haven't experienced that yet, but I've heard that that happens. And the couples that have practiced this, they're in the gold. They have a very beautiful way of communicating with each other that doesn't have to do with physical touch. So it preps you and it forces you to be intimate in other ways, which right, I would say
is. Yeah. So if you have a woman that has menopause, then does the mikvah completely go away, or how do you incorporate that?
It is sad for a lot of women. They miss the mikvah because it was such a beautiful, special partner life. When you're pregnant. So some of these really religious women who have babies all the time, they don't go to the mikveh that often because you end up getting pregnant kind of quickly and then you're not menstruating. So you're good to go the whole entire time. So for some, it's an incentive to always be pregnant. So yes, menopause and when you're pregnant, you're in your clean state, as they call it. And not in a dirty way that there's something wrong with you. They just call it a clean state.
Oh yeah. I also like something else that you mentioned last time, which is that it gave you time to focus on you. So there was like, during that time, it's like, okay, Because I think I shared with you that I'm Catholic, and that during Lent, I gave my husband an hour a night, like every single night that he's an ER doctor. So when he was working overnight, obviously it didn't happen, but like I really, really tried to give him an hour a night for those 40, however many, you know, nights between Ash Wednesday and Easter. And that was huge for us. And it wasn't always just about sex. Sometimes it was watching TV, or he wanted a back rub, or he wanted just to have some uninterrupted time with me without the kids. And he knew that was coming, but you were saying that during that 12 days that you got your time, and that if you slept in different beds, and that you could like do your work, and you could be a little bit selfish, and it was okay. And I loved that.
Yeah. A lot of women do look for that time. I tend to have more of an issue because I have a very, very high libido. So it's very difficult for me. And it becomes very distracting, the idea of every day, like I'm thinking about sex. Like you always hear about teenage boys every 7 seconds. I'm kind of like that. I work in the industry. I talk about it all day long. I have to use the water slide, you know, to keep up with, you know, testing my product. But there is a sense of relief where I'm not expecting myself to do something. And I would love to. It's not a chore in any way. I actually have a problem the other way. I have to tone down, because otherwise I might not be as productive, because I would do that all day, either masturbation or sex. So it's a way for me to keep that in check and be productive in other ways. And then when it is my time, I have no worries about just indulging in it 100%, because I know that I'm not doing it all the time. But I don't think that I'm normal in that sense, because I've seen doctors about it, and it's borderline, do I have a problem? So, but that's just personally for me.
That's just a good problem to have. It's interesting you talk about libido and cycles. Dr. Runnels wrote a book called Anytime for As Long as You Want, which was like the Amazon number one Amazon bestseller on sex for, I don't know, 2 years or something. It probably been out for 10 years or so now, but in it he talks about something called integrative sexual transmutation, which I think he might have coined the phrase, IST. But basically, it's written for men, but it talks about some of these ancient Chinese rituals where basically your timing, you can have sex as much as you want, and you should, but ejaculation, how it's draining, and that you have a cycle, and the cycle is calculated based on your age divided by a number. So my husband actually started doing this back in August. And the idea is like, if you, he quotes Thoreau and Walden and Benjamin Franklin and all these, Leonardo da Vinci and all these really creative, brilliant people. And why were they not really brilliant and creative until they were like in their late 40s and 50s? And it's because they were jerking off so much in their teens, 20s, 30s, that it actually slows you down. The prolactin that's released when you ejaculate is like, makes you sleepy after intercourse. And it's satiating, and then, you know, you keep doing it. So the idea is that you learn how to control your ejaculation and kind of sex surf, and you're on a cycle where you can have sex so many times per day, but you're only going to ejaculate every X days, like every 6 days, every 8 days, every 9 days, based on your age. And that there's this genius and creativity and energy that's actually created as a result of that.
Wow.
From the sex, but by not having the release, which is just, I mean, it all kind of ties in together, right?
Maybe that's why my off months or my off weeks, that's where I do find myself to be so productive. That's insane.
Yeah. So it's a very interesting book. I'll send you a copy of it so you can read it. And there's a PDF version too. But for women, supposedly, for most women, sex is actually an orgasm or actually energizing for most women. But, you know, not everyone's created equally.
Yes. I like to say the more you use it, the more you want it. So it builds your pelvic floor muscles, everything, your blood's flowing. But if you do it too much, you still get sleepy. It has the same effect on our body. But you're right, it does energize us. But with your point before with the book, I pull out my palette and I start painting during my weeks where I can't touch. But it doesn't say anything, by the way, about female masturbation. During those 2 weeks, we are allowed to masturbate when men are not.
Oh, okay. And so I believe it or not, I know I'm going to knock your socks off here, but I went to Georgetown University, which is Jesuit college, Jesuit university. And I wasn't Catholic at the time, but I read the entire Tanakh, like the whole thing. I did my first semester. My mother signed me up for classes and we were required to take religion classes, like a couple semesters. And almost everybody took this philosophy class called The Problem of God. And I was abroad in Ecuador and my mother got a hold of my registration. And she decided, because she was a literature English major, that Introduction to Biblical Literature was a more fun class.
Oh, that's fun.
We read the entire Tanakh and then we read the New Testament too. And analyzed it. And so we read Leviticus and we read all the norms. And so I'm a little bit familiar with the idea of spilling of the seed. And it's interesting, if you look back at what's considered sinful, it doesn't ever talk about female masturbation. It's all about the idea that you have a sperm that could meet an egg and could become a life that now isn't. So masturbation, I believe, if you really want to boil down the religious law for a male, anytime you're ejaculating that's not inside of a woman's vagina is considered the same level of sin, or, you know, I hate to call anything sinful, but in terms of if you're really going to read the Bible, and it excludes females then, because we don't have the seed, so to speak. So yeah, you can do whatever you want.
Our egg is not going away every time we ejaculate.
Right.
If anyone helps promote it.
Yeah, anything. Yeah, exactly. And you only get so many, right? You're actually, you have all of your eggs developed when you're in utero. And by the time you're born, I don't remember what percentage you've already lost, but it's a lot. And then you've got X number of thousand left and they just kind of start churning out. Women actually ovulate and as they get older, and I use older in quotes because I'm, you know, pushing 40, so I hate when people use the word older with regard to women and sexuality. But, you know, you ovulate more sometimes when you're 35 than when you're 27. It's still usually once a month, but you might spit out two eggs or three eggs, which is why even naturally conceived twins are more common for women in their, like, late 30s and 40s than they are, you know, for women in their 20s. Because you're more likely to ovulate multiple eggs. So kind of survival of the species.
Yeah. So when I came up with the idea for the water slide, I actually went to go speak to multiple rabbis about it because I just wanted to make sure I wasn't inventing something that was against my religion. So it was a really interesting talk because I said, okay, what's the deal with female masturbation? I created a product that can be used for hygiene and it can be used for self-stimulation. And I got the green light from every rabbi I spoke to. They said that there's nothing wrong with female masturbation in Judaism. If anything, it's viewed as a beautiful thing and a beautiful gift for women. They said, as long as you're not doing something to substitute a man, they said, everything is pretty much go game. Like even your biggest kink, they say, as long as the man is finishing in the vagina, in terms of the religion, right. As long as you're finishing in the vagina, you guys get as crazy. Also, they said solo, like no kink with other people, all that kind of stuff. But in general, you can do anything you want. You can do anal. You can do everything. Just finish, like clean off and then finish in the vagina. And they said the water slide, they said, this is a beautiful gift. You're using it for, remember I said when you're prepping to go into the mikvah, cleaning in the folds or around the folds, the vulva, they said, this is a great tool for cleaning. And during your time that you're in Nida, you can use it for masturbation. And then you could even use it before you're about to get ready. And if a woman has an orgasm in the bathtub, she's not done. A woman could have multiple orgasms. So it's a great way to get stimulated beforehand too. Where unfortunately, sorry guys, in the religion, it says men can't masturbate. And it's nice to see sometimes that build up of the man, when he's not able to masturbate and he can't have sex, you become like an animal, which is a lot of women that I know of really love.
Does your husband ever watch? Do you ever let him watch you bathe?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, because that's super hot for guys too, right? Like,
yes,
super hot.
so many levels. It's like, okay, you could watch this, but then it's like, all right, our water bill is getting really high. So ladies, only use it when you're filling up the bathtub to save water. But there's also a beautiful, like, romantic thing you can do with when your husband or your partner or anybody is behind you in the tub. You can lean back on them and your hands are free and their hands are free to do anything. And it's a really erotic thing, being with water, stimulating you.
Well, water is always associated with fertility. So, and you think about it, that's beautiful. I love that. I just think that a whole invention is so great and it's so cute. And I think for some women, there was some shame of, you know, I don't want to have to get batteries out and I don't want to have to go into some sex toy store and ask and try something out. You know, if you have a vibrator, they tell you you're supposed to test it on your nose or on the area right above your lip in the store. I'd say ladies, brandy wipe if you're going to do that. That's supposedly the vibrations that you feel. It's the most analogous to the clitoris. So if it's too strong for the tip of your nose or the filtral columns, which are the area between the nose and the lip, then that's what it's like. That's too strong for your clitoris. I thought that was interesting. But some people just don't want to have to rely on an extra toy. But then there's also women that I think feel that if they're touching themselves, that has a different sort of connotation than if somebody else is touching them or they're using a toy. There's this kind of space between, right? So I love the water slide because you're there, but if you're one of those people that doesn't want batteries and you can take it anywhere and nobody's really gonna know what it is because it's like a piece of pink plastic with this cute little ribbon, ladies, that ties around your faucet, but it's not something that you couldn't travel with. I mean, I totally travel with my vibrators, but I'm not gonna lie and say that the last time I was in the airport, I was shopping for like some Reese's peanut butter cups and it got knocked on in my travel bag. My bag's budding. Like, no. I just got to make sure that I take the water slide now. And I can make sure that every room I request is like not one of the ADA rooms where they don't have the bathtub. Like, I'll just take it with me and make sure I get it up in my room and kick it back old school to like when I was 15 also.
Oh, that's fun. And you'll take time. You'll have your time in your bathtub. Well, you could just let time disappear and it'll be a self-indulgent moment that you deserve.
Yeah, I might even shave my leg, Maureen, because that's about the only time I take a bathtub. Like, so much easier than doing it in the shower. You have all those missed spots when you're in the shower.
Yeah. And I would like to mention that it is, again, from my OBGYN's mouth, the most hygienic way you could become stimulated, second to your own thought. So even your hands, even a partner, it is the cleanest way. So if you have any issues with getting urinary tract infections, bacterial vaginosis, anything, this is, again, the cleanest way you can possibly do it.
I love it. We're coming up on summer in Texas. And I don't know about Connecticut, but they prorate our water based on how much we use. And in the summer, they charge like way, way, way more for water because, you know, people are hydrating their landscape or irrigating landscapes and filling their pools and stuff like that. So.
Well, I would say I'm from California originally, so I'm very water conscious. I love water, if you can't tell. So I do like to say only use it when you're filling up the bathtub. Even though you might be tempted to turn off the drain, you can start there, finish up elsewhere, but try to be mindful of water wasting and usage. So
I love that. Yeah. And I think that baths to me are like totally, I mean, I'm gonna hit this thing all summer long, but in the winter, especially like when that's when I think of like a fall to winter, like a cozy bath and a, you know, romantic fireplace, you know, fire in the fireplace and kind of a glass of wine and some soup. So again, I think that we pretty much hit everything, don't you?
Yeah, we did it. I gotta go to the bath now.
Yeah, exactly. I wish I had a trip coming up. I don't have another trip coming up for another month or so, but because I definitely am not gonna be traveling with batteries anymore if I don't have to. But again, Maureen's product is called the Water Slide. It's water and then slide, S-L-Y-D-E. And the website is waterslide.com and it retails for $24.95 and it fits almost every bathtub. It's just a plastic kind of a funnel of a clear plastic funnel that will channel water wherever you desire, ladies, in the tub. And it ties onto the faucet with a really beautiful pink ribbon. So thanks, Maureen, so much for being on. And I hope you ladies love this as much as I do. And thank you also for your just willingness to share some of your religious perspective. I know we don't talk about it, especially in today's society, about our differences and try to find the similarities among religions, which I think if you really dig deep enough, there are a lot. It's just that we don't take the time. We always just want to see how we're different. And I think that if we approach it from the way that we're all the same, if everyone could just do that in life, then the world would be a much happier place.
Oh, I love it. Thank you so
especially
much.
Especially if we all masturbated and had orgasms every day.
That's peace on earth right there.
Absolutely. And it's rabbi approved. So we're good.
That's awesome. Thank you so much. I love it all.
All right. Thanks so much, Maureen.
All right. Take care.
Bye. Thanks for joining me. If you have any questions, you can reach me at Dr. Porter at austinlovedoctor.com or go to our website, austinlovedoctor.com, if you have a question.
Thank you for joining Dr. Emily Porter, the Austin Love Doctor. If you have a question about your relationship or sexuality, please feel free to contact her directly at austinlovedoctor.com.